The first commercial CRT televisions went on sale in 1934. The technology had many variations and improvements over the years and remained the dominant display technology for about 70 years. We had liquid crystal displays for computers, especially portable computers, as early as the 1980s, but these displays were expensive, typically monochrome, and had terrible contrast ratio and viewing angles, so they were typically limited to use in portable computers. However, the technology continued to mature, and by the early 2000s, LCDs were finally in a position to replace CRTs in both cost and performance. Consumers especially loved the lighter weight and thinner screens that the LCD and plasma displays could offer. But now, I want to explain how these CRT displays actually work. It's something I didn't fully understand myself until I was in my 30s. So let's take a look. A cathode ray tube is essentially a vacuum tube, just like the ones you would have found inside almost any electronic device made before the 1960s. So let's look at a vacuum tube diode, one of the simplest types of tubes. At its core, you have the glass with a vacuum inside. Next, you add the anode plate, and then the cathode plate. And at this point, no electricity will flow in this configuration, but if you add a heating element to heat the cathode, then suddenly electrons will leave the cathode and be attracted to the anode plate, and electricity will be allowed to flow in one direction. Hence, you have a diode. Now, how do we convert this into a CRT? Well, let's turn it on its side, and then get rid of the anode plate, and instead put a ring here. At this point, the electrons will be attracted to the ring, but will end up flying straight through like this. We would call this configuration an electron gun. So if you just lengthen out the tube and give it an almost flat screen, and then coat the inside with phosphorus, now you have a device that will give you a bright dot right in the center of the screen. And that's because when the electrons strike the phosphorus, it is converted to visible light. And so, with a little modification of this monitor, that is exactly what I have here. As you can see, there's a little dot of light right in the middle of the screen. I've turned the brightness almost all the way down so that the dot doesn't burn the phosphorus, but actually I'm going to turn it up just a hair. Well, a dot in the middle of the screen doesn't really give us a picture, but what if I take this magnet and put it near the dot? Electrons are affected by magnetic fields, and so you can deflect them around like so. In fact, some CRTs, like those found in early vector-style arcade machines, would use electromagnets simply to move the dot around on the screen very quickly to draw lines. And so this brings up a question I get asked a lot, which is about pixels. Well, CRTs don't really have pixels, the way you might think of them. There's no set resolution of a CRT. You might compare it to an Etch-a-Sketch in that regard. I mean, you can draw lines on the Etch-a-Sketch, but there are no pixels as such. However, there is certainly a limit to how closely you can draw one line to another and still be able to tell them apart. And we refer to that limit as the dot pitch. So here's what the electromagnets look like. These are referred to as deflection coils or a deflection yoke. And it will go around the neck of the tube. And by the way, if you think the back of the CRT looks a lot like the bottom of a vacuum tube, well, that's because that's exactly what it is. Anyway, the deflection coil slides right on the back of the CRT like so. In a nutshell, you have electromagnets operating in all four directions, which allows the device to move the electron beam anywhere on the screen. Now, one interesting aspect of this is that the magnets themselves determine the geometry of the screen, as can be seen here where we haven't aligned the yoke properly and the screen appears tilted. In fact, what I'll do is I'll carefully rotate the yoke like this and observe how the picture also rotates on the screen. Of course, with this computer image, we're seeing a raster-based scanning system where instead of drawing lines on the screen, the beam moves in a repeating pattern that covers the entire screen 60 times per second. And that allows us to produce nice pictures like this, or nice computer text, which, by the way, is still affected by the presence of a magnet. Now, you can do this all you like with a monochrome screen, but please do not do it to a color screen, and I'll explain why later. And so, what I've shown you is the fundamental basis for every television set produced from the 1930s to the 1950s, when color television was introduced. Of course, black and white televisions, as well as monochrome computer monitors, were still produced well into the 1990s, typically as low-cost options. In fact, this monitor I'm showing you here was manufactured in 1984. Now, looking at the inside of electronic devices made prior to the 1960s, the technology almost seems alien to me. And even as a kid, I had always heard that vacuum tubes were no longer used in anything. But the reality is, every television and computer monitor still contained at least one vacuum tube, as did every microwave oven in the form of a magnetron. Okay, so obviously everybody knows that color televisions were later developed in the 1950s, but what a lot of the younger generation may not be aware of is that they did not completely replace the black and white televisions. In fact, the two coexisted for decades, with the black and white option always being the low-cost option. However, when the computer age of the 1970s and 80s came along, monochrome monitors were popular not only because they were the cheaper option, but in many cases because they were the sharper, more high-resolution option. And you'll see why as I show you how these color CRTs work. Ultimately, the color of the screen is determined by what sort of phosphorus mixture is used to coat the inside. Some monochrome screens are green, some are black and white, some are amber, etc. So imagine if you used three different phosphors for red, green, and blue across a screen like this, you could get different colors in different parts of the screen. That may not be all that useful, but a similar approach was used in games like this Moonbase game, where a monochrome tube has color filters placed on top of it, and that makes parts of the screen appear different colors. And as long as you have a good separation between your various objects on the screen, that works decently well. But an actual color CRT will employ three separate electron guns. The front of the tube will be coated in either stripes or dots of red, green, and blue. And then a piece of foil with holes cut in it, known as the shadow mask, basically blocks all electrons except for the ones meant for the specific colored area. So, to better illustrate this, here's an example of a shadow mask looking at it from the vantage point of the electron guns. In this case, we're looking at the front of the tube from the red electron gun, and if we change our vantage point over here, you'll see only green, and over here you'll see only blue. If you look up close at my Samsung television, you'll see that it uses the stripe pattern. Now, at first you might think by looking at these pixels that there aren't complete vertical stripes all the way up and down the glass. But that's because what we're really seeing is the shadow mask. If you light up the front of the tube with a UV light, for example, you'll be able to see that the red, green, and blue stripes do in fact run the entire length of the screen. And here's a monitor that uses the delta pattern instead. Now, I said the CRTs don't really have pixels as such, and that's still true for the most part. Even though the shadow mask makes it look like there are individual pixels, it's nearly impossible to control specific pixels in the way that you might think. The electron stream is most likely larger than any one of these pixels. So, let's say you're trying to light up green in this area. It will probably paint a circle larger than that, but the shadow mask will block it from the non-green areas, so you'll wind up activating several green spots nearby. This example illustrates this, where I've drawn a red, green, and blue dot on the screen, and as you can see, there's no one-to-one ratio of the dots drawn on the screen. But rather than explain all this with diagrams, I thought, why don't I just break one open so you can see all this for yourself? So I have this 19-inch color CRT from an arcade machine that no longer works. And after VCF, I had a little get-together at my house and I asked everyone to sign it before we destroy it. I think that this is the most people I've ever had in the studio building at one time. Anyway, and now that the tube is properly signed, it's time to disassemble it. So my friend DJ came over to help with this project, and it turns out we don't need to release the vacuum because we figured out what the problem was, why this tube no longer worked. Apparently it was broken at the neck, right behind the plastic here. So the vacuum seal is already gone and it's full of air now. We discussed a dozen different ways to do this, everything from water jets to saws, but decided to go with this method. Now, we decided to take the neck off first, which is pretty easy to do. That little metal thing is called the getter, and it's put in there to help remove any impurities after manufacturing. And if you look down inside, you can see the three separate electron guns. And after scoring the glass all the way around, DJ gave it a good hit with a hammer, and it came apart really easily after that. We'll pull this metal shield off so you can see the shadow mask, which is the main thing I wanted you to see. And before we pull the mask out, I just wanted you to see some of the phosphor has already come off because it's just attached like a powder, and the loose debris inside was enough to rub it off. And here's the shadow mask. The bracket it's attached to is fairly firm, but the mask itself isn't much thicker than aluminum foil that you would have in your kitchen. I'll try to zoom in so you can see the pattern here. And just to show you how easily the phosphor coating comes off, DJ just rubbed his finger across it. But believe it or not, this stuff is laid out on the inside in tiny stripes of red, green, and blue. I'm not quite sure how it was applied at the factory though. After breaking the glass more, here's a piece of the front and you can see the individual stripes better. And now I want to show you an interesting comparison. Look at this Commodore SX64 with its built-in 5-inch color display. I want to compare how certain pictures looked on a similar size monochrome monitor. In this case, the dot pitch used by the shadow mask isn't really very good, and thus really limits the clarity of the text on such a small monitor. And this is most likely one of the reasons the original Macintosh used a black and white monitor, because Apple wanted to emphasize its use for things like word processing and later desktop publishing. But by the late 1990s, the difference in dot pitch between monochrome and color was so small that no one really cared about monochrome anymore. Another thing I'd like to mention is the magnet we talked about earlier. I said never do this to a color CRT. If you do, this is what will happen. Because the shadow mask is made of metal, it can become magnetized and cause the electrons to go through the wrong holes, giving off the wrong color. Most color CRTs employ a degaussing coil, which creates some alternating magnetic fields briefly at power-up. But it's often not enough to cure this kind of problem. Thus, you need a special degaussing tool like this to solve the problem. There are some other ways to do color, such as the Sony Trinitron, but I'm not going to get into that in this particular video. But what I've shown you is probably the most common way color was achieved. But now I want to talk about some of the advantages of CRTs. And yes, they were replaced by LCD screens, and for good reason. But I want to make something abundantly clear. I was an early adopter of many new technologies. I was one of the very first to own a DVD player or a digital camera, a USB flash drive, an electric car, and yes, an LCD monitor. There are people in this world, and I've seen it time and time again, who despise new technologies and change and new ways of doing things. And they will insist they're going to stick with the old technology forever because it's so much better. And I've seen some people hold out for a really long time with their VHS players and their film cameras and yes, their CRT displays as well. And so I just want to let you know that I'm going to show you some of the things that CRTs still do better. But that doesn't mean that I want to convert the world back to CRT displays. It just means I can be objective. So let's have a look. The first advantage CRTs have is contrast ratio. If you aren't familiar with the term, take a look at these two bars. You should notice that the one on the top has a deeper black and brighter white than the bar on the bottom. Thus, the top bar has a higher contrast ratio. The CRT basically creates light, much like a light bulb, at each point on the screen. So if the light is off, it can be very black. For a CRT, black is the default color. An LCD uses a backlight and thus white is the default color. In order to make it dark, the liquid crystal has to attempt to block as much light as possible. But it can never achieve a true black. So take this dark scene from Star Wars as an example. Now I'm going to exaggerate this for the purpose of an illustration, but hopefully you can see what I mean about the CRT having a higher contrast ratio. This is something I can't actually prove on a YouTube video. It's the same conundrum as trying to prove whether or not the audio from a vinyl record sounds better than a compact disc while being compressed over YouTube. I mean, you simply can't do it. The only way to make the comparison is to be there in person. Another advantage is the ability to display different resolutions. And what I mean by that is the tube itself is totally resolution agnostic. Much like I talked about with the Etch-a-Sketch. So you can change resolutions on a CRT without sacrificing sharpness, whereas an LCD monitor does have a set number of pixels and needs to run at a set resolution. Otherwise, a scaling algorithm must be used, which doesn't always look so great. Next, let's talk about input lag. Now the funny thing is, this term never even existed in the CRT era. There was no such thing. Modern HDMI displays require some amount of time to process the image frame and display it. Newer monitors will have a game mode, which helps to minimize this time delay, but it doesn't eliminate it completely. And this issue brings us to the next item, light guns and pens. The fact that the video chip in the computer or game console knows exactly what pixel is drawn on the screen at any given time, it's possible to use things like light pens and light guns, which can see if a specific area of the screen is illuminated or not, with precise timing. And the last one will be a bit controversial. It's about longevity. Now, at first glance, the LCD screen would seem to have the advantage, as it doesn't suffer from burn-in like you would get on a CRT when the same image is displayed day after day and year after year. As you can see, this tube from a Pac-Man arcade is extremely burned in due to decades of displaying the same image every day. But early LCDs that relied on a fluorescent tube for a backlight often became dimmer over the years and would even change colors as they aged. Modern LCDs use LED backlights and at least don't suffer from that problem. So I think in terms of hours of operation, the LCD probably has better longevity. But imagine you found an old CRT television from the 1940s in a warehouse somewhere that has never been used. Okay, it probably won't work when you plug it in, but it probably won't require that much repair to get it up and running. You may need to replace some capacitors, for example, but you'd have an 80-year-old television that works. Now, imagine an LCD screen built today. Do you think it will still be working in 80 years' time? Probably not. LCDs develop a number of problems over time, and one of them being vinegar syndrome. Usually between 20 and 30 years of age, these screens will spontaneously start to decompose, delaminate, and self-destruct. Okay, so most of my comparisons have been against LCD screens. Now, obviously, I realize there are other display technologies out there, like plasma displays, OLED, or DLP, among others. But I was largely comparing with LCD because I think 20 years ago, LCD was the thing that primarily displaced CRTs once they reached price parity. And so that's the reason most of my comparisons were against LCD screens. Now, there is one more thing I want to talk about in this video, and it isn't specifically unique to CRT displays, but it is relevant, and that's aspect ratio. I'm not going to sit here and tell you whether 4x3 or 16x9 aspect ratio is best. I think it's largely subjective. However, what I do want to talk about is the way screens are measured and how this can often lead to misrepresentation. Now, the way you measure a screen, of course, is diagonally. And in the days of CRTs, there was, of course, the often disputed issue of whether a tube should be measured in its visible area or the size of the tube in general, which is a bit larger. Now, for example, my favorite little Samsung TV is supposed to be 13 inches, yet when measuring it, it's closer to 14 inches, and without the plastic bezel in the way, it's even bigger still, probably more like 14.5 inches. In fact, the service manual refers to it as a 14-inch tube. So Samsung was being fairly honest here. However, some manufacturers in the 1990s would claim the screen size as the size of the tube and not the viewable area, which gave them a slight competitive edge when consumers were looking at advertisements and prices. It's not much different from how some cheap digital camera manufacturers would advertise interpolated resolutions instead of the actual resolution of the sensor. But let's talk about comparing sizes of 4x3 screens to that of 16x9. If you take a standard size of the era, like a 17-inch computer monitor, and let's say you picked the widescreen because you felt you were getting more screen for your money. But if we overlay the area of a traditional 17 monitor, something doesn't seem right. So your fancy widescreen was certainly wider, but what you gave up in height doesn't make up the difference. To make matters worse, if the 4x3 were advertised at, say, $349, but the widescreen was advertised at $329, most consumers would look at this and say, hey, they're both 17-inch monitors, and the widescreen is cheaper. What a good deal. And I can't help but think about the story of when A&W released their 1/3-pound burger at the same price as McDonald's 1/4-pound burger, but found that most consumers believed the 1/3-pound burger was actually smaller. And so that's my main gripe with 16x9 displays, is that I feel like a lot of people got tricked into buying one thinking they were getting a good deal. But that's all ancient history now, and I guess we have reached the end of the video. So as always, thanks for watching.